Good morning, this is Mike Pasiello here, Friday morning, last day of the conference with CSUN ATC TV and studio. Really glad to be here this morning with all of you and glad that you've all tuned in for us this week. We have a number of great presentations. Don't forget, this session is being live streamed. If you want to go see the sessions that have happened previously during the week, check us out on our CSUN ATC TV YouTube station. This morning, we have a very special guest with us, Leticia Lacfius. If I have the name quite wrong, please forgive me. You've got a very special program dedicated to children and adults with dyslexia. Can you kind of give us, Leticia, a little bit of an introduction of what the program is and the technology behind it?
I can. Thank you very much. First of all, thank you very much for having me. I'm very honored to be part of the conference and to have like a few minutes to tell you about the app. So the app we are launching is called MyDys. And MyDys is here to help the millions of American and actually people all over the world that are battling with dyslexia. So if you allow me, I'm going to talk a few minutes about what is dyslexia. It's an impairment, a cognitive impairment that is touching 11% of the population. So it's a lot of people. Just in America, it's 41 million people that are battling every day with this impairment. The federal law defines dyslexia as an unexpected difficulty in reading. And for me, this definition is very important, and the key word is unexpected. Mm. What it means is that the rest of the brain is not impaired. It's just a little area in the prefrontal cortex that commands reading that is impaired. And this is key for how we built this app. So what does that mean, unexpected difficulty in reading? Several people battling with dyslexia are encountering several problems. First of all, they have difficulties to see the spaces between the words. Or more precisely, they don't see the difference between a space between two words and a space between two letters. So in other words, a sentence looks like a very, very long word. So it makes the reading and the comprehension slower and more difficult. Number two, their eye rarely reads a line from the beginning to the end, and rather their eye drops from one line to the other. Again, another obstacle for understanding what you're reading. And last, which is the characteristic that is the most commonly known about dyslexia, their brain inverts some letters because the brain considers that they are too similar. The best example is a B that can be seen as a D, as a P, or as a Q. Mm. The U can be seen as a N, the 6 as a 9. So when reading a text, the brain is never 100% sure of what they are reading.
Right, very good. That's very interesting. And I really appreciate an in-depth description of what dyslexia is, because sometimes I think people tend to think it's a visual disability. In fact, it's not. It's always been cognitive. And the fact that we have such a large population, even here in the United States, never mind worldwide. So it's an important topic to address and deal with. But before we get a little bit more into MyDys, your app, can you give us a little bit more about your background? Where are you from? Where is the company based? Where are your offices and things?
Well, you might have noticed a little accent when I'm speaking. I am from France, and so is the company. So MyDys was born within a sister or mother company that is called Facility, and we are pioneers in assistive technologies. We started in 2018, and we have a strong commitment in making everyday lives easier for people with disabilities. So we started in the digital space, and with MyDys, we are taking our knowledge to the real life world.
Excellent, real world application that we can use. Mm-hmm. So let's talk a little bit about the application.
Yeah.
How did it come about, and what does it do, and who does it serve?
Yeah. So if you remember, at the beginning, I spent a little bit of time explaining what is dyslexia and what how this impairment translates when you're reading. So when you open my DIS, it's going to look like a camera. And you can capture an image of a text that you're trying to read. With OCR, optical character recognition, this image is going to be converted into text. And then what you can do is that you can personalize a display of this text on your screen with settings that are going to help your brain to make sense of what you are reading. For example, you can choose the font that is the easiest for you to read. Oftentimes, it's Comic Sans. It's a very common font used by dyslexic people. You can also use Open Dyslexic, and we have a list of five or six fonts that you can use, number one. Number two, I was telling you about the difficulties for people with dyslexia to identify the spaces between the words. So with MyDys, you can space out the words until the space is big enough that your brain can see it without any difficulty.
Do the proper interpretation of what is actually coming.
Exactly.
There,
yeah. You can also space out the lines so that you don't drop from one line to the other. And last, and this is for me the most interesting, you can indicate which letters are difficult for you to recognize. For example, the B and the D. And then the app is going to highlight all the B's in one color and the D's in another color. Why does that help? If you remember, I used the federal definition, the federal law definition for dyslexia as an unexpected difficulty in reading, meaning that the other area of the brain are not impaired by dyslexia. And especially the area of the brain that commands colors is not impaired, is not affected by dyslexia. So we are tricking the brain here. Adding a little color to a letter, it's going to help recognize which letter it is using the color.
Very, very interesting. I should have asked this from the beginning, but you seem to have an in-depth knowledge of dyslexia. And I know I have a couple of very close friends who are dyslexic themselves. One of my close friends, Gareth Ford Williams, used to be with the BBC. He's now a private consultant in the UK. But one of the things that we've always talked about are, one is, there's not necessarily every case of dyslexia is the same. And you've kind of highlighted that. But what is your actual background in reading dyslexia, cognitive science at that level?
Well, we have been working with a group of experts in France, speech pathologists and dyslexia experts. But more importantly, we have been constantly working back and forth with users. And they are the ones that are giving us the best feedback and the most valuable feedback in order for us to build on the app and continue developing it. We just launched the app. It's like brand new. It was launched at the beginning of the year at the Consumer Electronics Show. So we only have 2 months of experience, and we keep adding features that are the most useful for people with dyslexia. My biggest pride is to know that we have tested, we have actually measured the efficiency of the app on people with dyslexia, and we have seen that users that are heavily affected by dyslexia usually understand about 25% of what they read, and with the app, this percentage jumps to 84%.
So you're seeing measurable progress, yes, right away out of the box.
We
That's
do.
Great. I think something very important, because we talked about this from day one of the conference, and that is the inclusion of users, the inclusion of people with disabilities in the design, in the development, and in the testing of anything that we build, right? Because there unfortunately has been a pattern over the years for companies to just think, well, I can come up with a solution and this will fix the problem, right? Mm-hmm. And the reality, and then they do not involve users with disabilities. Mm-hmm. So What you just said is we get a lot of feedback from our users. We're using that as a basis for measurement or making adjustments and tweaks, as if I can use that to the app itself. What other benefits are you hearing in terms of feedback from your user base? What are they saying that they like about it in terms of use?
I'm going to answer your question, but what I come to realize, and neurodiversity is one of my personal passions, and I'm pretty sure that it's one of the biggest untapped opportunity in the corporate world.
Neurodiversity.
In France, we do have inclusion laws that ask companies of a certain size to employ a certain percentage of people with disabilities. And they do it kind of because they have to, not because they want to. And I think that's the biggest mistake. Because hopefully soon, but in the future, not now, we will realize that people with disabilities, certain disabilities, make employees better at what they do. And right now, we are not there yet, but I hope that with the work of MIDIS and all the other people, I didn't have time to visit all the fabulous exhibitors that are here at the CSUN conference, but I'm sure that at some point we are going to change the world, and hiring, employing people with disability is not going to be like something we have to do anymore. It's going to be a strategy from the companies.
Very good. So again, a little bit more on the app. So it's mobile. It's on a mobile, so I can run it on an iOS, an iPhone device, and Android, both of those
Yes,
platforms?
Absolutely. When we launched the app, it was only on the Apple Store, but the Android version was released, I think, a month ago or 6 weeks ago. Yeah. So you can download it on your iPhone, Android, or tablet.
Okay, very good. Excellent. So that gives us a wide breadth of where we can install it. So I can install it as a user, and then I can start to configure it so that it will work in accordance with my limitations or that I'm dealing with it from a cognitive standpoint in dyslexia.
Yeah.
Good. Now, we've talked about, in essence, two groups of people. So let me tackle ones that I think is really important, and that's education and children. Mm-hmm. Because perhaps getting an app like MIDIS into their hands and getting them using it at an early age, maybe even preschool, will help them to get through, you know, school and education a little bit easier. So are you building into that market? Are you expanding in that market?
We are, absolutely. For several reasons. Number one, the app is very useful when you start your journey in the reading process, and especially when you learn. So that's where we want to start helping people. Number two, I'm very sensitive to the children that have a disability, because I often make this parallel with myself. I know that I have a heavy accent, and if you, Mike, decide to make fun of me right now for my accent, it's going to be fine. It's going to be fine. I have the tools today, you know, to know that you're making fun because, like, whatever are your reasons, it's not going to hurt me so much. When you are a kid and you're trying to read and your peers are able to read and you are the slow reader, it's a big trauma, because whether we like it or not, there still is a stigma around disability. And even though dyslexia is an invisible disability, it still is something that as a kid is very difficult to live with. So the young children and teens are our number one target.
Excellent, very good. And you and I were talking before the show as we came on. There are a number of nice conferences. I mean, it's great to launch it at CES. It's the largest technology conference show that's out there. But there are conferences like the Assistive Technology Industry Association's conference in Orlando, Florida, where there's a lot of education and children and teachers that are there that go there. Closing the Gap up in Minneapolis is another good conference. And of course, we're glad to have you here at CSUN, because this is the premier conference for AT. So we are hoping that we'll see you and my dis and your presence here at the conference more. A little bit more on the adult side now, because you know, as you noted, I thought I was going to have to bring it up, but you captured it nicely. Dyslexia, like many cognitive disabilities, is one of those invisible disabilities. Mm-hmm. And often, because of the stigma associated with it at an early age, it doesn't get revealed, right? People don't know, and you kind of struggle through life. But you'd be amazed, I think our audience would be amazed, at how many people actually have a form of dyslexia. Mm-hmm. And CEOs of corporations, very large corporations that are well known that have it too. So how now do we take MyDIS as a pervasive mobile app and make sure we get it in the hands of workers and folks so that maybe the stigma of being dyslexic it becomes less so?
Yeah, well, how we bring it to everybody needing it is still one of my challenge. I've been exhibiting here at CES, at the International Dyslexia Association annual conference 2 weeks ago in Los Angeles. And it's funny because every time I present the app, I always have the same answer. Everybody knows someone, their son, their daughter, the neighbor, the husband, the wife, that is dyslexic. So so I think it's really here to help a lot of people.
Very good, very good. So you're here at the conference and you have a booth. What do you know what the booth number is?
Yes, it's 1303.
1303, so yeah. Folks that are listening and the folks that are here in our audience, we want to make sure and encourage you to stop by and visit with Leticia. The application is called My App.
My Dis.
And you have demos there at your booth?
Yes, I can run a demo. And you can also download the app for free.
Good.
The app is free to download and to use up to 30 scans a month. So one picture is one scan. And then if you want to use it more, it's $2.99 per month. But the CSUN conference is offering 1 month for free to everybody that attended the conference. So awesome. I have QR codes on my booth and invite everybody to come and take one.
Wonderful, wonderful. In your website, what's the website address?
It's mydis.app.
Mydis.app, very mm-hmm. good. Leticia, thank you so much for
thank
being
you.
With us here on CSUN ATC Studio and TV. It's a pleasure to have you here, and we know that your company is dedicated to improving the lives of individuals with dyslexia. Thank
we
you
are.
So much for being our guest.
Thank you.
Thank you. So this is, again, Mike Passiello from CSUN ATC TV Studio. We have a wide range of programs following us this afternoon and this morning. We hope you'll come down here to our studios in Platinum 9 and Platinum 10 and see the rest of our weekly programs. Thanks so much, and signing off. Hey, good morning. Back here again at CSUN ATC Studios. Thank you very much for attending, and we have studio audiences as well. We have a very exciting, very interesting follow-up to some of the conversations that we've had earlier this week in terms of the future of interfaces and where we see emerging technology and technology for people with disabilities going. We've got three panelists with us this morning, Dylan Box, Crystal Marte, and Dr. Greg Van Rijn. Now, you all could be doctors for all I know. All I know is that they introduced me as a doctor, and I'm not, so there you go. But maybe, Dylan, could you give us a little bit of your background as we get started and introduce yourself to the audience?
Yeah, absolutely. Hi, everybody. I'm Dylan Fox. I am the head of community and outreach for XR Access. We are a nonprofit research initiative of Cornell Tech focused on making virtual and augmented reality accessible to everybody. My background's in user experience design and research, and really pleased to be here to chat about the future of interfaces.
Excellent, very good. And Crystal, please.
Hi, everyone. My name is Crystal Marte. I'm a second-year human-computer interaction master's student at the University of Maryland. I was the project manager for the Future of Interface workshop. I've been working with Greg Vanderheiden for the past 2 years now, and it's been incredible. Also, I've been conducting research in people with dementia and older adults with Amanda Lazar. And I'm really excited to be here, so thank you very much.
Very nice, very nice. And by the way, you can look at us. You don't have to look at the audience if you don't have to. I don't feel like you have to. And Dr. Van Heiden, please.
Yeah. Greg Van der Heiden. I'm the Director Emeritus of the Trace Center, having handed that over just recently to Jonathan Lazar. One of the co-founders of Raising the Floor, a nonprofit organization that's working on Amorphic and this future of interface projects along with the Trace Center.
Excellent, thank you, Greg. So let's get right into it. The Future of Interfaces Conference, which was huge. I loved it. I haven't seen all of it yet, but I've caught a lot of pieces that were really important. Very exciting, you and Vint put together, Vint Cerf. I'm sure most of our audience knows who Vint is. Crystal, can I start with you, if it's all right? What did you think of the conference, the event, and where are we going with the future of interfaces from your perspective?
Yeah, definitely, I can get started. So planning that was definitely a hard thing to do.
Yeah.
Trying to coordinate a bunch of incredible speakers, you know, from all different areas. We have AI, computer vision, machine vision, direct brain interfaces, you know, as well as accessibility, cognitive learning, language and learning, XR, AR, and VR, you know, getting everyone together, and having them be able to speak to the future was an incredible moment. So, that was great to have them all there. And in terms of where we're headed, there was a lot of things that we talked about. I think one of the most important things was, for example, in AI, not looking at it as something that we should depend on. It's gonna be a tool. Technology at the end of the day is a tool, and it can't replace a human being. So how can we sort of reframe how we think about technology and not sort of have a dependency on it and not put the burden on the individual to learn these new technologies? How do we remove that burden from them and treat it for what it is?
Excuse me, sorry. If you could get me some water from the back, that would be good, thank you. Dylan, XR Access is very focused on mixed reality, extended reality, virtual reality, all of those things have been pioneered over these last few years. So where does it fit into the future of interfaces?
I think for me, it's kind of right in the center of it, right? I think when we think about interfaces specifically, one of the reasons that I'm so fascinated with virtual and augmented reality, particularly from an accessibility point of view, is that in a lot of these new tools, like artificial intelligence, for example, amazing capabilities, but it's still using a lot of the modalities we're already used to, text in, text out, images in, images out. Virtual and augmented reality, I think, is a fundamentally new form of interface. It's something where the interactions that we have to define there are drastically different from anything we've seen before, that you'd use, a mouse and keyboard or a touch screen. There's a whole new kind of realm of motion controls, gaze controls, voice controls, interactions in a 3D space instead of a 2D one that are emerging that I think we're trying to find solutions to, and particularly that we're trying to find accessibility solutions to. I've been having demos for folks here at CSUN, and I'm sorry to say that, we've got a lot of different cool stuff with individual features that we like to showcase, but there's still not any really VR, AR applications that I would call 100% accessible.
Yeah.
So it's something that is still a big challenge area and a lot of new territory for us to explore.
I mean, it's interesting you brought that up because I think, and Greg, you know this way better than just about anyone I know, but the whole history of platform accessibility, regardless of what that platform, it's always been a challenge to try to build, from the ground up that accessibility. So, Greg, along those lines, what can we expect in the future? What's tech going to look like in the future as a result of the conference? What do you think?
Yeah, this is one of the central core purposes. The purpose of this conference was, and we brought the top people from the country in each of these areas from mainstream work on day one, and then the second day, the top people in accessibility. And we asked them, where are we going to be in 20 years? And this is always a fun thing to try to do, is to guess where you're going to be. And the visions we have are that we're going to be seeing some really quite amazing potential opportunities. We could be seeing the VR, AR without any goggles, okay? The one person was talking about the pathways to and from the brain, and all those, there are billions and billions of cells. There's only I forgot what the number was, 14,000 or something, pathways. And so that's a reasonable number. And that's the pathways for into and out of the brain. And so if you can take the signals from those and or inject signals into those, could we have it that in the future somebody just gets an inoculation? Mm-hmm. And the little nanites go through and they attach to the places where they need to, they connect, and then all of a sudden we don't have to carry anything. It's like not having to wear glasses because you have, you know, LASIK or something. You wouldn't have to have a display. You want a display, it's there. You want a keyboard, it's there. You want a tactile keyboard, you just pull out a something that has keys and you just type on them just to have a tactile keyboard, but you don't need it. And this opens up a whole bunch of questions. First of all, will that work for everybody? If somebody has cerebral palsy, it's not their cortex, it's actually the lower parts of the brain that cause the problems. If we tap above, can we give them back the motor control? Can they be faster typists than the rest of us? Mm-hmm. Can people think? They're actually talking about thinking and having the text come out rather than having to do it. They talk about subvocalization, where you just think about saying something and it comes out. So I see two things. One is, when you have all of these types of things, how are you going to make them accessible? And that brings it right back. And whether they're projected using today's technologies or they're virtual in the future, the same research that's being carried out by the XR team is going to be applicable. But it may also give us tools that are going to allow us to solve problems that we can't solve today. We have cochlear implants that give hearing to people who didn't used to be able to hear. Will we be able to do the same thing with vision? But the one I worry most about is cognitive language and learning, particularly intellectual disabilities. Today there are people who don't have any, quote, disability, but they struggle with technology, and we put everything on there. Mm. And if they're struggling with today's technologies, what's it going to be when there's just, you know, everything around and you've got this massive flow of information in and out? Mm. Are we going to be creating a new level of disability or a new level of inequity from people who can handle this, from people who can't handle it? Mm-hmm. So there's a lot of really interesting questions, but one of the ones that I think is most interesting, and we focused a bit on that in the workshop, is with the new large language models and things like this, can we have it so that when somebody says something in a complicated way, we could have an assistive technology that would change it into a simpler form, mm-hmm. okay? And so this isn't fancy displays or anything, it's just putting it in a different form. And the nice thing about it is if we do that, we could have it be whichever level each individual needs.
Right.
And it actually can be down here till they understand it and then up so that they could actually adjust by topic.
So again, it comes back to something. I'm here and I'm listening to you and I got 16 other questions in my head. Which one should I ask first and how to get them in the right order? But it does come back to a couple of things you said from the beginning. One is we have to ask questions. We have to, you know, to really understand where are we dedicating the research that we're doing to get to these interfaces that we hope will adapt, right? So we were talking about the other day about finally getting interfaces that adapt to us rather than humans having to adapt to it, right? So we're moving in that direction. But to me, that presents a number of new types of challenges. I mean, how do you see that in terms of challenges now for tech as we move forward? I mean, Greg, you just talked about one of them, right? In terms of cognitive interpretation of data and how to do that. And I keep thinking, harkening back to the five weight days with Clayton Lewis, as to how he emphasized the importance of cognition in those aspects that we needed to address, which in terms of standards and laws and things that are being put together, really were not, we just weren't discussing because we didn't have the research to work with. So Dylan, anyone, I'm opening it up. What kind of challenges are we gonna get?
Yeah, I mean, I think a ton of them, right? Any new emerging technology, any new capability is gonna run into all kinds of friction as we get started. And I think it's gonna be important to find ways to balance it, right? One that often comes up with regards to augmented reality is privacy, right? Because let's say that you have somebody who's blind. Something they might find really helpful is facial recognition, right? To be able to recognize who comes into the room. Now, if that facial recognition is achieved by constantly taking video of everyone around you and putting it on some database where, you know, companies can mine it for profit, that might not be a trade-off that a lot of folks are willing to make. So I think it's very important that as we're constructing these new technologies, we build in the values that we share, right? So for example, in this facial recognition thing, you know, Microsoft, I think, did a good job of this on the HoloLens, where it will keep certain things on the device. It will not put it online without your consent. And maybe that means that it's a slightly more limited application of it, right? It can't recognize anyone off the street, but you could still, for example, train it on the people that you know and care about, that you see every day, and just think about the consent and the what we're doing with our data, and whether it's ours and what price we're paying for these new functionalities. So I think that's vital.
So privacy and security, not surprising, right? I mean, that seems to be the theme of the century right now that we've all been dealing with. Crystal, thoughts from you in terms of challenges and barriers that we can perhaps anticipate will come even with the emerging technology?
Yeah, definitely. One of the things that came up in creating the research agenda was quantifying, you know, the impact of these technologies on people with disabilities. So for example, you know, it was talked about a lot during the CSUN about how people with disabilities are this untapped market. You know, how can we frame that? So when we're creating things like grants and we're trying to push for funding, how can we show that there's actually this huge population that's not being tapped into that we're neglecting? And in addition to that, you know, framing is really important, like I mentioned already. But in terms of quantifying people with cognitive language learning disabilities, one of the things that you'd have mentioned was the fact that, you know, how can you quantify the impact or how it helps someone that has a cognitive disability? You know, that's one of the things. It's hard to, like if you're blind or if you're hearing impaired, for example, it's easy to, there's things that are testable, you know, and it's hard to test for things like cognitive language and learning. So that's one of the other challenges that was brought up as well, you know, given that people with cognitive language learning disabilities are often ignored and in terms of building these end technologies, but for incorporating this population, how can we think about, you know, quantifying that impact?
Yeah, that's a great point, because I think, again, we often talk about inclusion and including users with disabilities, people with disabilities in our research. But, you know, have we really quantified, as you said, what it means to test, and how do we design those tests? Because we interaction models are going to be different depending on the type of disability that they have. So that definitely presents a new set of challenges as it relates to these emerging technologies. So, Greg, these technologies, the future of interfaces as they're starting to develop, we're kind of bordering, well, what we can expect in the future. But the thing is, can any of these technologies help us now? Can they address some of the challenges that we're working with today?
Yeah, one of the key focuses of the whole workshop is the creation of a research agenda so that when we get to the 20-year point, we will actually have, so we aren't always playing catch-up, which is, you know, the theme in our field, as we all know. But so the research agenda, the R&D agenda, is one of the key aspects. And even though the workshop's over, we've just begun in the process of creating that agenda. And the agenda, as you point out, is not just how do we make it work 20 years out, but how do we get it so that from here to there, what are all the steps along the way? And already we're seeing things. Large language model, for example, as we talked about. If you ask them, they're based upon just looking at all of language and predicting, you know, what would words follow which and things like this. And then people try and ask them, you know, like, you know, who is God? And, you know, and they try and mess them up by saying, you're a monkey. Now, you know, do you like nuts? And things like this. But if you use them the way they, where they're strong in the language models. I believe that within 5 years, we will be having not just prototypes, not just research papers at a conference, but actually AT out in the field working with people with disabilities that will be able to tap these. So already we're going to be seeing some of these things in the short run. And then in the same things that will help us in the short run, even with the AR, VR kinds of things that are coming out of this group, we'll be able to then apply them in one form now and another as the technologies advance.
Yeah.
So this is going to be a real important part is to figure it out. But the most exciting part is some of the disabilities, deaf blindness, cognitive language and learning that we've not been able to treat well. We're now getting some tools to begin doing it. But the one thing that in the research agenda I really want to see us focus on is that we talked about individual interfaces. I believe in the future that we will have the ability to give each person their own individual interface that matches their abilities even as they change over time. Except when, if you gave it to us today and you said, okay, we can give you, you know, for each of these different people with disabilities, we'll custom make one. What should it look like? We don't know.
Yeah.
You know, cognitive, you will say, oh, it should be simpler. Yeah, well, how simpler? Simple in what ways? Exactly.
Right.
And so I think a huge amount of research needs to be taken, done for us in the disability area to actually figure out exactly what it is. And we can't, I think we've, the era of talking about the blind or those within this, you know, like this whole group is all one homogenous group, mm-hmm. is gone.
Yeah.
And we are now on a exciting but scary new path of, okay, if you can design one-on-one, how do we know about going about how to try to do that?
Yeah, exactly. And I really do like, so again, future of interfaces is all about here's where we want to get and how are we going to get there. BJ Fogg always promoted the notion of baby steps, small steps, take small steps to get there. And I always appreciated that because the great thing about taking small steps is they are usually easier to measure and then easier to talk about and then easier to teach. And then they often lead us into other branches of research that we can expand on from there. So taking that approach, as you just outlined, I think is excellent.
Yeah, one thing I think we always have to think with a split mind. If we always do baby steps, then sometimes you never get to where you want to go. If you think of mountains and valleys, okay, and where the best place is over here, but if you're over here, you think that the valley is right here, but there's a mountain. But sometimes you need to get over there to get to where you really want to get. So if we always think incrementally, then we always thinking backwards. How do we take the technology we have now and make it better? Sometimes we need to leap. So one mind has got to be in the stage-wise thinking, but the other mind has got to be just erase the board. And if we could start from scratch, what would it look like?
Yeah.
And so we want to actually have a split personality, if you will,
yeah.
Thinking incrementally and then also just forget everything we have. If we're going to design it all from scratch, what should it look like?
Yeah, I love that aspect of it. For years, I've had a certain opinion, just a personal opinion, about the design of screen readers. I've always felt that they were done wrong. I still think that they're done wrong. I don't think that they really have been designed in an interactive model the way that a blind or even low vision user can properly and most effectively interact with, and Crystal says this is part of the HCI, human-computer interaction. And so there's one of the things. I'd love to erase the board on screen readers and start all over and try to figure out how do we really do this? How do we really make it work? Let's see. So you talked about a new approach to accessibility in the future. Can you tell us a little bit more about what that is, what that means, and what can we expect?
Well, that was something that Sina Bahram and I had presented at the conference. And this is, again, this sort of split approach. One side is talking about taking and figuring out how companies can make their products as they ship more accessible, inclusive design. But somebody pointed out that if you take the, you know, where we are and where we need to be, and you watch progress, it's kind of went like this, but it's starting to level out way below up here. And someone did a study, and like 3% of the home pages were accessible. That's just the home page. That's a really low percentage. So if all that time we made great progress, and there are particular products that are really accessible, but how about all the rest of the world? You know, people don't live on one product their whole, you know, they got to live all of it. So we took a second approach, which said, what if we had something that we call like an infobot that can look at anything? It's look at a thermostat, a microwave, HBO, you know, the different things on TV, all of which do the same thing and all look different. And they look different from one month to the next as they get a new designer in there. Where the accountant figures out if you scramble them around, they make more money, so they scramble them all around. And older people, you know, they're just lost. What if we had something that could look at any interface, and then it would understand it, okay? And then on the back, it would have an individual user interface generator. Go back what we talked about. It creates an interface just for that individual, okay? Now, the person, when they go to HBO and 10 different of these systems, and they all do the same thing, they would see the same interface. Mm-hmm. And when it changes, they would see the same interface. So for the first time, us older folks, as we get up there, aren't going to get confused by the fact that the thing keeps changing. But if they go to a hotel, they would look at a thermostat, it would give them an interface. So, and it would give them one that fit. If you're blind, it wouldn't be an auditory interpretation of a visual interface, is what you're getting at, you know. The thing that's scary to me is that there are a lot of blind people who can't use screen readers, and they can't figure out how to use the iPhone built-in mm-hmm. thing either. And think about it. You're blind, and you can't use a screen reader. You're cut off.
Yeah.
But I think there, if it was a more of a natural model, as you're talking about, but how do we get there? And so that's the kind of thing. So we continue to make them reach as far as you can with inclusive design, but then you have, I guess, what amounts to some kind of a super AT, if you will, that can work so that now a person who can't currently access would not only be able to access those things where someone cared about access, but they'd be able to access any interface. So how do we get there? A whole lot of research has to be done. It looks like the part about machine recognition and stuff is actually going to be there before the part about disability groups actually understanding us as disability researchers, understanding how to do it. You were just talking about this other way of thinking about screen readers. You know, does that work? You know, of course, we all have great ideas, and then when we try to implement them, they always have limitations. So we've got to be working with consumers so much more and learning so much more about.
That's what the goal of the conference was, right? To get all these folks who are vested and vetted in emerging technologies and assistive or accessible technologies to start thinking about these new ways. Dylan, again, from an XR standpoint, and you know, there are a number of different realities, so to speak, that are involved there. How does this fit in with the XR mission?
I think it fits in a big way, because we're just talking about the need to invent new screen readers. Well, that's exactly what we're working on right now for virtual reality, because, you know, for normal screen readers, you have an HTML web page, it has structure, it has headers, it has links, it has landmarks. How does that work in VR? How do you subdivide a virtual reality space into something equivalent to that headers, right? If I'm totally blind, I'm in a VR space, how do I find out a high-level overview of what this space is about? And I think there is a huge opportunity for AI here, both in terms of the end-user side, as, you know, let's say I'm blind, I don't know how to use a normal screen reader, maybe I can ask an AI, can you summarize this page for me? Can you help direct me to the part I want to go to? I think that's an incredibly powerful idea that I haven't seen explored very much yet. But I think we can also leverage it on the creator side, because we can't use AI. You know, I think we see this problem with accessibility overlays. People put an overlay on their site, and they're like, great, it's accessible, I don't have to worry about it anymore. No, do not use an accessibility overlay, please. It is not a substitute for thinking about the accessibility of your site. And neither is AI, right? I think you can have an AI that can, like, you know, maybe you didn't put alt text on an image, and an AI can look at it and see, oh, I think this is what this image is. But that doesn't capture the intent of what you may have wanted to put in as a creator. And so I think it's important to think about these tools that we have, both, yes, you know, we'll put them in the hands of the end users, of the people with disabilities who can use them to help fill in these gaps, but I think it's also important to think about it from the perspective of advising the experts, advising the creators, right? I know there's a lot of folks right now trying to use AI as lawyers with very mixed results, but it's interesting to think about AI as a way to advise creators to help them make their stuff more accessible, right? You know, we have prompts right now. When you upload an image to something like WordPress or Twitter, it'll say, hey, do you want to add some alt text to this, right? And I think thinking about it from that perspective of having part of the creation tools include an AI or just simple user interface that advises you, hey, we want to help you make your application accessible. Here's some things you can do to do that. Make sure that it's the burden isn't just on the end user, but it's also on the creator to make sure that their work can be enjoyed by everyone.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. So we're talking a lot about functionally intelligent agents, right? And how do you teach AI to be intelligent? Frankly, that's what we're discussing. But I want to switch the conversation just a little bit, Greg. We had talked a little bit earlier about pluggable user interfaces. And you've been touching on it just a little bit, but maybe you could expand on that for the audience. Because we've talked about, it seems to me, I could go back at least 20, 25 years, and we were talking about pluggable user interfaces being used in a number of different modalities. Can you talk about that?
Yeah, and we have one of the experts, Sherry Trewin, right here, who worked on the pluggable user interfaces. And it's interesting because you have to think about all the forces. So we worked and even developed all the way up through an international standard for pluggable user interfaces. And then we'd come into a company, unnamed, and the researchers all loved it. The product manager said, came in and found us meeting there with them and asked us to leave, told us not to come back, and told the research that they were never to talk to us again because as long as he was ever product manager, nobody was ever going to use their product while looking at somebody else's logo. And what he meant by that is if our products just become like a screen and the device here is the one that controls it, then when it breaks, why would you buy the same brand? You just buy whatever brand that's going to plug on the back. And they were right. Now, Alexa's broken through that some. And some of these, we've seen some large forces break through. But still, this idea isn't there. So that was one of the reasons why it went to the iBot approach, which it basically says, we'll just use whatever interface you have, and we'll just it will look at it like a human does. It will operate like a human does, if you will. And so it doesn't depend on any cooperation from any place and to make it, to create a socket. So that's one of the key things is that whatever you do, whether you're dealing with AT or dealing with mainstream industry, if your path to accessibility goes through their profit line, it isn't going to happen. And it's not because anybody's evil or anything else. It's that they can't afford to put themselves out of business. And by the way, these are publicly traded companies, so the evil people who own these things that care only about profits, that's us, okay? Mm. We're the stockholders, and we buy stock because it'll make money, not because it does, you know, other kinds of things. So we need to think, to just keep in mind all of the market forces, try and figure out how to do something that's a win-win. You know, it's a win for an industry, it's a win for consumers, and those are going to be the paths, I think, that we can go forward. I did want to mention one thing before, because I forgot to mention earlier. All of the presentations from the Future of Interface Workshop, as well as a whole exploratorium of interfaces, including all of the visions of the future from the past all the way, are all online at futureofinterface.org. And that's where the communication continues, the conversation continues, and the building of the research agenda. So I wanted to invite not just the researchers, I want the consumers, policy, everybody to follow, contribute, and help to shape this research agenda going forward.
So that's all one word, futureofinterfaces.org?
Futureofinterface.org. Just one word, .org, yeah.
Excellent, very good. So we would definitely want to invite everyone in the audience and those that are watching online to visit that site. So as we wind things down here, it occurred to me that there were some things left unsaid or maybe not fully addressed. So let me kind of take, Crystal, can I start with you first from your perspective? What kind of things maybe, especially as the organizer of this thing, that you thought might happen and didn't happen, or at least maybe they just weren't fully addressed?
I think one of the most important things, and it was kind of addressed at the last session, which was the agenda creating session, was all of this really does start with employing people with disabilities. Not just having them during the product development process, not just testing with them, but employing them as researchers, as people a part of your organization, you know, academia, industry. If you don't have these people like as a part of your organization, then how can you really have an inclusive future?
Excellent, I love that, very good. Employment of individuals with disabilities, very good, thank you. Dylan?
I think one thing that I'd really love to see explored more is the idea of tech transfer from academia to industry. I have read so many papers where people make these amazing prototypes, and I'm like, this is spectacular. Why can't we turn this into a product right now? And then it just kind of languishes in some academic database somewhere, and maybe some folks read it, but it's really not living up to its potential. I think that's one of the things that makes this type of, you know, the Future of Interface Workshop and things like CSUN so helpful, is to surface some of that work. But I think we definitely need a better pipeline of academia to real industry so that we can take these amazing inventions that some of our best and brightest minds in the world that have gone to, you know, spending their time in labs and getting PhDs, creating these things that never see the light of day outside of that lab. I think that's just a crime. And I think we really need to think about how we can accelerate those into places where people with disabilities can actually use them.
Excellent, very good. And Greg?
I'm actually going to echo Dylan. I was going to say something else, but I think what you said is so important. First of all, you need to understand that the job of universities is to create researchers and create research, not to create products, okay? But we expect them to do the whole job. Now, industry takes products that you can make money off of and goes forward. Where's the missing link? You know, accessibility, we have AT companies, and they make AT for money to, you know, so that's it. But a lot of what we need to do is this huge interaction between the two, and there's nobody to do that, and there's nobody that funds it. I want to do a shout out for the National Institute on Disability and Rehabilitation Research and Independent Living.
Nice.
And they're part of ACL, the Administration for Community Living. And they're one of the few organizations that are focused on outcomes to impact people with disabilities. NSF does research in this area, but it sort of stops at the idea level. You know, they fund research to create new ideas for doing that, but there isn't the carry through. And this is a real problem. So I would like to see a greater emphasis, and it's hard, on funding to do not just, it's called the Valley of Death, and you can actually see NSF papers about it. You know, the research like this, and then there's no funding, and then once it makes money, it's over here, and you get funding over an industry. And here's where all the ideas die, is in this Valley of Death.
Right.
More funding, more emphasis on not just getting a paper, not just getting a peer publication, but actually getting an idea out and into the hands of people with disabilities.
I would be remiss if I didn't mention, we are actually right now part of a National Science Foundation accelerator program that is trying to, we're working, XR Access is working with Lighthouse for the Blind and Benetech on a way to convert nonverbal communication into sound and haptics so that people who are blind can be first-class citizens of the metaverse, I think.
Excellent.
Is what we're going with.
Excellent.
So some of these programs do exist, but we definitely need more of them.
Very good, very good. Yep. Well, I want to thank, did you have one more thing to say, Greg? Or, no, is it. Well, I want to thank our audience. I certainly want to thank our panelists, Dylan Fox, Crystal Marte, and Greg Vanderheide for being with us. The future of interfaces, where are we going, emerging technology, but most importantly, how are we developing interfaces that are inclusive and usable and accessible to people with disabilities? That's what this is all about. Can we give our panelists a nice little round of applause? Thank you. This is Mike Pasiello with CSUN ATC TV. Thank you all for joining us. We hope you enjoyed our session today. And we've got a few more coming up right after this.
Conference.
Hello and welcome to the CSUN ATC TV broadcast studio for the second to the last presentation of the show. Today's is Accessibility Trends at IBM, and we've got quite a distinguished panel here. I'd like to start out introducing Phil Jenkins. Phil is the accessibility executive at IBM Design. To his right is Chico Asakawa, who is a distinguished computer scientist at IBM and also a researcher. And then to the far, to Phil's left is Nina Roby, who's a digital accessibility program manager, SME for Red Hat Digital Experience Systems. So I'm gonna start with Phil. You're a CSUN veteran. Give us some perspective of what you saw at the show this year.
What did I see at the show this year? Wow, I've been coming to CSUN since 1997. And I consider CSUN like the number one event in the world about this space and disability and accessibility, assistive technology. And there's a little bit of shine off of CSUN this year because we're still coming out of COVID, but the talks were phenomenal. The whole point of, I think the quote was from somebody, serendipitously bumping into someone. So literally on my left is Nina from Red Hat, and I'm from IBM, and we were kind of not supposed to talk to each other. It was like an us and them thing, you know, the thems, Red Hat and the thems, IBM. But we literally met at the table after a session and kind of found out, oh, we're both working on accessibility and we're both here together. That wouldn't happen in a virtual conference, okay? And I wouldn't see or had the opportunity to work with Chico, let's not work with Chico, see Chico's AI suitcase and touch it and feel it and walk around the room and find the vending machine with my eyes closed. You know, that kind of stuff doesn't happen at at any other kind of virtual event. And it only happens at CSUN because it's like the best of the best internationally get here. So I had a list of other things I can talk about what I saw. Here's another one. We work with a gal called Alex, her name is Alex, and she uses the term craptions. Okay, those are bad captions. All right, well, I heard yesterday about some studies of captions that are built with AI. So everybody's bragging about how AI is so much better at voice recognition. Okay, so in 1962, we demonstrated voice recognition for the first time. That's 60 years ago, okay? So now we got really better error word recognition, but AI is starting to hallucinate on its captions and starting to invent stuff that's not in the text because the person might be talking about one subject and then it'll switch to a different subject and the AI starts remembering what was spoken about previously that has nothing to do with the new topic and starts inventing phrases and words that aren't there in the audio. So that's another example of a trend that saw here.
Okay. Chico, you had a very distinguished career at IBM. Can you give us an idea of a little bit of a historical about your career, and also if you could tell us, how many times have you been to CSUN?
Okay, so let me introduce myself first. So I'm Chico Asakawa. I'm an IBM fellow working in the area of accessibility research since 1985. So my earlier contribution in the area was development of Braille digital technologies, such as Braille editing system, Braille network system, and Braille dictionary system. And after that, the internet was appeared. So I was very lucky to develop the IBM homepage reader. So the IBM homepage reader brought me to the global accessibility community. So it was when I started attending the CSUN. I think it was the first CSUN experience was the end of 1990s or earlier 2000. At that time, I was really impressed because, you know, this conference is really special. A lot of, you know, users with disabilities and without disability get together. I've never seen this kind of conference, you know. I attend, you know, human-computer interaction conferences, academic conferences, and we share what we do in the community to help people with disabilities. But, you know, very, very few disability attendees there. So this conference is very, very different. So as a researcher, I have been really, I really feel this conference is very valuable for researchers and engineers to get together with disability users. We develop technologies for people with disabilities. However, you know, it's not that easy to talk with real users. And it's very important to communicate and to hear their feedback because they are the one who will deep with the technology what we create. So I want to keep coming back to CSUN to, because yes, I'm of course the user and researcher. I'm blind. However, I want to get more users' feedback. So I really feel this is very valuable. And maybe I can talk about my latest work later.
Yeah, thank you. We'll come back. Great, thank you very much. Nina, this is your first time at CSUN. Do you have any first impressions?
Absolutely, yeah. I mean, I'd just like to echo actually some of the things, that the points that my colleagues here have just been talking about. From the moment that I walked in here, there's just such an incredible atmosphere, you know, amongst all the participants, the friendships that have obviously, you know, blossomed over the years of coming back to see some, that's been remarkable to see. And as you were just saying, the mixture of people with disabilities and people without disabilities, it's incredible to see the friendships, the collaboration, the sharing, and also the care that and consideration that's gone into making sure that this event is inclusive of everyone. Yeah, I've had some, you know, really interesting serendipitous meetings with people. My colleague here on the right, that we just bumped into each other and started chatting about things, and we have so much in common, and I've learned so much from his many years of experience. I also, believe it or not, I'm from the north of England, and while I've been here, I've bumped into two people separately who were actually from the same small town that I'm from in England. It's remarkable. I bumped into a lady, Julie, in the exhibit hall a couple of days ago, and we literally bumped into each other. And she said, "Are you from the north of England?" And I said, "Yes." And we ended up talking we had a really good 40-minute conversation, and then ended up going off and having lunch together. So, yeah, it's really been an honor to be here. It's been a remarkable, probably one of the best conferences I've been to.
Excellent. Are there any sessions that stood out to you?
Well, there have been actually a number of sessions that I've really, really enjoyed. Your session. I'm not just saying that because he's sitting next to me. But that was a really interesting take on stumping the designers. So for those who didn't attend that session, We were looking at two different designs, and we had to guess, we had to say which design we thought was the most accessible. And it was just a fun and engaging session, but also what I thought was really interesting was the conversations that then followed about, you know, why was that more accessible, or what were causing the barriers, and how could we improve that even more? And that's definitely something that I'll be taking back with me. I actually also really enjoyed the session on data visualization and the experimentation that has been going on with sonification and voice, automated voice with SVG charts. That was a really interesting session too. So yeah, I'll be following up with their work because they're obviously going to continue developing that further.
So I'll ask Chico first and then follow up with Phil. What are some of the recent things you've been working on at IBM?
Okay, so in my earlier career, I focused on the information accessibility because when I became blind, I found there are two difficulties for the blind. First one is information accessibility. We had a hard time to gain information by ourselves. And another one was mobility. I found it's really difficult for the blind people to walk around independently. And finally, around the 2010s, we found AI, robotics, and a variety of sensors are getting available in our real world. So after 2010s, I have been focusing on the real world accessibility. But to, you know, make the real world really accessible, you know, we really need a lot of technologies, like, for example, perception technology to recognize obstacles, including pedestrians, and you know, things like that. So I thought we really needed to work collaboratively with across organizations. So in Japan, we launched and one of the example is the development of AI suitcase. AI suitcase is a navigation robot for the visually impaired. And so it works something like this. So when you hold the handle of the suitcase, it starts moving. And when you let go of the handle, it stops. And on the suitcase, there are LiDAR sensor and RGBD cameras to detect obstacles and pedestrians. And inside the suitcase, we have GPU and a computer, battery, motors, things like that. So suitcase moves like an autonomous robot. But the difference is user holds the handle, then the suitcase can lead the user, similar to a guide dog. So that is my recent work. But to develop such a navigation robot, we really need to combine various technologies. And the first example was perception technology I just mentioned to detect obstacles, including pedestrians. And second, we need control technologies to smoothly move the suitcase robot in a crowded environment. And the third is haptic and tactile technologies and audio interface for notifying the user about surrounding information. And of course, we need basic hardware technologies such as batteries, motors, and so on. So it is not, you know, possible to realize only one organization. So we have been collaborating with, you know, industries and academia. And one of the example is we have launched AI suitcase consortium with four large Japanese companies, Omron, Alps Alpine, Shimizu Corporation, and IBM are working together by, you know, combining each company's strengths. And this time, we first demonstrated this AI suitcase at CSUN. And we are very happy to have various feedback from users in the US. One of the interesting comments we received from user is, people in the US, I mean, you are taller than Japanese. So our suitcase was a little bit shorter. So we user told me that, okay, you have to make it a little bit higher. So currently the handle is fixed due to complicated, you know, cable connections. But, you know, we have to change our priority. We really have to make the handle removable. You know, changeable. So, but, you know, users gave us a lot of comments, so we really enjoyed working with users in the U.S. this time. Thank you.
Phil, any thoughts on what you're working on that you can talk about?
Sure, there's lots of things. So I got to, I said, mention, use the suitcase. Just one really fun point is that it has this huge battery in it. And so I'm talking to the team, and they go, yeah, we had to classify it as an explosive to import it into the U.S. from Japan to get it here. I'm like, those are the kinds of real-world challenges that sometimes you don't know about. You don't know about, you know, some of these things, tall people need handles higher, things like that. But the fascinating part of having the vibration points on the handle and the stop-go and let-go, I mean, these are examples of where real people with real disabilities are involved in the team. Now, Chieko is an IBM fellow, just so you all know in the audience. So an IBM fellow is the highest level of technical achievement you can get. I mean, they use the term executive in my name, but let me just tell you what that really means. So you're a business development executive in IBM when you're like the top business development sales guy. You know, it's really not that cool, but it sounds good. So that's why they stick it on there, okay? So the credit here needs to be with Chieko. And working with Homepage Reader with her way back in the 90s was part of what started my whole career in accessibility. But recently, we've been focused on, okay, people want to test the keyboard. The keyboard maps to so many things, switch devices, even voice command and control. So when you say jump to the next link, it's almost like hitting the tab key with your voice, okay? And so we found out that there's websites with hundreds, even 500 tab stops on a page. And so to test that manually, you're literally clicking the keyboard 500 times. I mean, come on, can we fix that? Yeah, so we've been working on automating the testing of the keyboard accessibility. And then we visualize the pattern of the keyboard path automatically. You don't have to click it and record it. The machine does it for you. And you can see when things go zigzag up skewampus that it's not in the right order, we're reading the table the wrong way, you know, we're stopping on things that are nowhere, and we say, oh, that thing should be on the page, but it's off the page, somebody crazy did something goofy, or maybe you need to go check it out. So all that's what we're working on right now. Hundreds of rules to make this cheaper, quicker, faster. This is all open source, so I'm not selling anything. You know, we're really trying to solve some real problems. And when we say open source, I'm really saying, because I learned it from her boss, Jim Whitehurst at Red Hat, that it's open development. So it's not like Phil in the office in Austin. It's Phil in the office of all these other engineers around the world trying to work together. It's open development.
Okay? Excellent. Yeah. Nina, anything at Red Hat you can talk about in your role as digital accessibility program manager?
I'm excited to go back and share a lot of the experiences that I've had here at this conference, for sure. In fact, I've been messaging my boss backwards and forwards throughout the whole conference, and she's really looking forward to catching up with me and learning about the experiences that I've had here. I've made lots of notes that I'm taking back with me. I definitely got a lot from the sessions on training and development, the importance of shift left, and bringing in better accessibility best practices across all areas of the development life cycle. I think that's definitely been a common theme that I've seen here at the conference, and that I think is really important to take back too. So,
any other key takeaways from the show?
Yeah, I mean, like I said, shift left definitely is important.
Just to comment on that, the shift left. So we got all these designers shifting left.
Yeah.
I counted 7 Figma accessibility toolkits. Not one, 7. I mean, last year there weren't any.
Yeah.
So you find that at the conference, and that now we, you know, the next step might be to kind of maybe collaborate a little bit better and work together and improve, take those 7 and make 1 better or 2 better ones, something like that.
Yeah, I think the collaboration is really important. That's definitely something I'll be taking back with me. And also I think, like, the importance of the engagement of everybody across the organization, that it's not just about having a core accessibility program with a few people working on accessibility, but it's about bringing everybody on board and making them feel that they're part of that, and it's important across the organization. It just makes so much sense.
Chico, anything you can talk about in the future that you see challenges down the road that you're finding solutions for now or planning to find?
Yes. So my dream is to, you know, implement new technologies like the AI suitcase and navigation robot for the visually impaired into society. But, you know, we have to solve various, you know, problems or challenges to send such a robot to the users. So let me introduce 4 of them. So, of course, we have to tackle the technical challenges because, you know, really, we need technology to make it work safely and naturally. And the second one is a social acceptance challenge. You know, maybe you can imagine if some robot is near you or next to you, you would be really, what should I say, worried or curious what this robot is doing. You know, with a lot of cameras and sensors, is it okay? Maybe we should go away from this robot. So that is not what we expect. So we really need social understanding. People, we need to let people know what the robot is doing. So social acceptance challenge is very, very important. So not just solving the technology, but also we have to always communicate with people to get the societal understanding. And the third challenge is business challenge, of course. So it has to be feasible for users or for whoever to accept this kind of robot. So for this purpose, we really need to consider the use cases, not to just support blind people, but maybe this kind of technology can help, you know, elderly people, because, or people who are not good at directions. So even you can see, you get lost. You know, this is very interesting because I cannot see. Whenever I walk with friends or somebody, and I can tell, oh, this person is good at the directions, but this person is terrible. Because I cannot see, I can tell easily. So, but anyway, when I walk with someone who cannot, who don't have a good, you know, directions, or I think maybe our technology can help him or her. So we have to think about the business model. And then another, the fourth one is the infrastructure challenge. So currently, our robot cannot communicate with elevator, for example. So we have to ask user to push the elevator button. But near future, if the elevator has an API that robot can directly communicate, then, you know, user doesn't need to find a button by themselves. And this would be, of course, helpful for the AI suitcase, but it's going to be also helpful for people with hand motor disability or whoever, you know, find difficulty to find buttons. So, and also traffic signs. Currently, traffic signs are closed. So robot cannot communicate with the traffic sign directly. There is no open API. But if the traffic sign can be connected via the network or Bluetooth signals, we can directly get the information if it is red, you know, green or something like that. Of course, a camera can detect traffic lights, signs. However, it makes mistakes, unfortunately. So, you know, so such kind of infrastructure challenge should be also considered. But to be considered, we have to keep sharing the importance of these needs from people with disabilities. And I always mention, maybe when I said, oh, we have to solve these four challenges to implement this kind of robot into society. However, it's not only for people with disabilities. I always share this history of accessibility. So accessibility needs studied to help people with disabilities, but it doesn't stop there. So let me give you one example, or not only one, but anyway. So telephone was developed in 1800s while developing a communication tool for hearing impaired people. And voice-based speech technologies like voice synthesis and voice recognition technologies, such technologies have been nurtured by the needs of people with disabilities. And you know, Bint Cerf, he is a father of the internet protocol. He has hearing impairments, and he wanted to communicate with others more smoothly using the computing network system. So it led him to develop the internet protocol. So the accessibility needs has been, helping the mainstream computers. So I really hope the needs of the assistive robots will open up the necessity of technologies not to people with disabilities, not for people with disabilities, but for everyone. So I really dream near future robots help people with disabilities, but robots will also help people without disability. And by combining such necessity, we can achieve societal understanding. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Phil, in your role as a business development guy, always looking at the market and what you picked up here, what do you see as future trends that you're going to think IBM is going to address?
Yeah, future trends. So I think a good way to think about trends, I was telling Nina that trends is talking about time, right? Because there's always a dimension when you say trend, like where's it been and where are you now and where are you going and kind of where do you want to go, left or right, you know, with your suitcase guiding the way. So I looked up a couple of things. So AI, you know, I was in a bar watching the Watson computer do Jeopardy, okay? I don't know if you've seen that, but that was a big moment for me. It was like, oh, the world is changing. But you know when that was? That was 12 years ago. And look what's going on. You know, the trend I see is that AI is now everywhere. It just started in 2011, I think, but now it's everywhere. It's in a suitcase, okay? It's in every half of every booth. It was in the exhibit hall. But yet, in 2018, a year later, I think it was, a few years later, working with Sherry Truen, and we were looking at AI fairness. She was looking at it, and I was kind of taking notes and doing grunt work. But, that was 2018, the first AI fairness and bias workshop was led by IBM up in New York. We brought in people and said, hey, we have some bias going on against people with disabilities in the AI world. You know, when the cameras look at a person and the person is in a wheelchair, is it going to say something different than a person standing there or be able to distinguish between different kinds of people's facial expressions? You know, those are things that happen. Move a little bit. Earlier, I was working on some AI in Australia, and the AI voice recognition was doing great, okay? Except when we brought in a room full of people with Down syndrome who were gonna use this new disability insurance scheme with Down syndrome voices, and the AI was crap. It was crap AI or crap voice, you know, like craptions. It just didn't work. And why? Because we forgot about that segment of the population when we were doing the voice modeling. So we got some research funding down in Australia, and they're trying to build some voice models to fix that. Yeah, I think it was Nina joking to me that says, yeah, if you're a white male in your 40s, I'm no longer in my 40s. But anyway, when you were, those voice recognitions work best because those are the guys developing it, right? And so the trend is, I think we got to look at that history and kind of pay attention to where things are going. And coming to a conference like this, I don't know, it just kind of hits you in the face. You know, it's like, yeah, AI wasn't everywhere, and yet I saw a talk on AI fairness, and it was like the same talk I gave in 2019. You know, it's like, it's slowly getting out there. So I don't expect it to move as fast as we kind of think it might, because like I said, voice recognition has been going on for 60 years, almost older than me, okay? And yet, there's a lot of hope there, and you see a lot of stuff happening. What's another trend? I wrote some notes down here. There was something else I wanted to mention on trends.
I know relative to AI as a college parent, kids in college, that AI is big in their lexicon with ChatGPT and an all-nighter, you know?
ChatGPT is really, that's another milestone, if you will, along the way, because it made it, the press is picking it up and just, you know, making it aware. So I think that the more we can get accessibility into that press, well, you know, they eat it up and they want to promote it. So maybe we can take advantage of that. I'm surprised we don't have, you know, CNN or NPR here with a suitcase.
Nina, any trends that you see coming down the line that you're looking at from Red Hat's perspective?
I'm kind of interested in the personalization. There's been a lot of talk about personalization and the whole idea of giving options in the user experience, because, you know, we're all unique, we all learn in different ways, we all, you know, we think differently, and just providing those options in the user experience, I think that's an interesting idea for me and where that's going to take us in the future.
Excellent. So what we'd like to do in the remaining minutes we have, Mike, if you can get an audience mic up, is take some questions. I didn't mean to spring that on Mike. Just raise your hand, and Mike will come by with a microphone. Does anybody have any questions for our panelists? Okay, then.
So nobody's going to ask about my socks? I mean, I wore these special. These are my IBM Rebus socks on. So I have a T-shirt that says IBM, and nobody did.
Can we get socks at the booth?
So when we talk about the trend, I want to mention one example. So maybe you talk about the GPT, but there is a, you know, image generation AI these days. So if I asked the AI to create some kind of image, like maybe please create an image, the robot help people with disabilities, and the robot is surrounded by children. Please create such image. Then AI can create such image. When I experienced this kind of AI, I thought, oh, it's going to be, we can use this kind of technology or AI to create slides by myself. Because currently, I cannot create, you know, nice visual slides by myself. But if this kind of AI becomes more available, it will help, you know, open up the job opportunity for the people with disabilities. And it can help improve our quality of life. And this kind of technology, I could never imagine such technology can become available 30 years ago or 40 years ago. So our future is going to be very interesting. We should dream, you know, our future is going to be changed by using technologies.
That's an example of a little epiphany. So we've always been thinking about AI as describing the image, you know, 1,000 words to describe the image. Now, Chico just revealed to us that what if you gave the AI 1,000 words and it drew the image for you or for her or for whoever else needed to draw images. I mean, that's pivotal, okay? Stuff like that happens at CSUN, guys.
Interesting perspective. Well, we want to thank our panelists. Phil Jenkins, who is an accessibility executive with IBM Design, Chico Asakawa, who's a distinguished computer scientist there with a distinguished career back to 1985, and Nino Roby, who is digital accessibility program manager, SME for Red Hat Digital Experience Systems. Let's give them a big hand. And just a reminder, all of these sessions that we've done, including the one coming up at 1:20, will be available on the CSUN YouTube channel. They're all up there now, archived as morning and afternoon for each day, but they will be broken up by session as soon as they get a chance to edit it. So just want to remind everybody about that, and thank you for attending this session. I'm Dave Gardy from WebAble TV.